She was just playing and she was like putting toys away and she was just by herself there. And I was like in another room, but still close by that I could hear it. And she was just putting something and she's like, what the fuck? And I was like, and I was like, and I literally was in another room, like Googling what I should do in this case. I was like, what do you do when your child says the first cursing word?
Hello, it's Eglantina Zingg. You might have heard some things about me, perhaps. And yes, I am all of that and much more. And in my podcast, The Zingg with double G, I will be sharing my views, thoughts, opinions on culture, society, feminism, sex, and all of it. All of that everyone is thinking, but no one dares to talk about. Every Wednesday, I will be offering you a new episode with incredible guests from celebs, friends, big names, authors, artists. And also, since I love talking to myself, will be only me talking my head. The last episode of the season will be exclusively for you guys with my subscribers. So we'll get to chat, I will get to read some of your DMs, play some voice notes, and talk basically of whatever you want. So don't forget to subscribe, join the fun, and listen to The Zingg every Wednesday. You can find The Zingg at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Amazon Music, or wherever you get your podcast. Follow me at Eglantina Zingg, Z-I-N-G-G, to DM and get in touch. Let us explore and lose control. Eso, Vita!
Hello!
Hello!
I'm training my voice.
Let's do it. High or low?
High. High?
I am low.
Low.
Ooh.
Ooh. I feel like it's like erotic. It's like a different direction.
It's also good. It's like, man, should I stay or should I go? It's like there's no middle ground.
No.
Bueno. Welcome to a new episode of The Zingg. I'm going to fix my microphone here. All this beautiful audience, mis amados, bellos y preciosos. Tenemos un nuevo episodio hoy with a beautiful, beautiful girl who it's a Victoria's Secret model, a super top model, a tastemaker, an influencer, a content creator, a mother, a wife, a former Russian or originally from Russia, but now we have adopted her in Miami and she's a Miami local, Vita Sidorkina.
Sidorkina. Don't worry.
Welcome to The Zingg, man.
Most of the time they call me Vita S and there is a reason for it, so.
Vita S?
Yeah, Vita S.
Like, I said,
I mean, you can call me Vita S too. I'm from
a
pretty good
bunda,
one.
Ella tem bunda. Vita is an ass. She's
Vita
taking people.
An ass.
let's start for things first. How actually do you pronounce your name? Because we all say like, and even in my name is so complicated.
Yeah.
How do you pronounce yours?
Eglantina?
No, but yours.
Oh, I thought you asked me to pronounce yours.
No,
I'm like, I thought it was a test. But I practiced it
she
before.
She practiced. She's good. Eglantina, perfecto.
Actually, it's the first time I ever heard a name like yours. So it was interesting.
We're
going
to have to go
name.
Play the Loto today mm-hmm. because when it's the first time. And if you hear about the Amazons, you're going to get drunk. But today you cannot get drunk.
No.
Because we're not two, we're three in this podcast.
We are. My name is Vita for short, but my actual name, which not so many people know, is Vitalina.
Vitalina.
Yes.
¿Y qué significa Vitalina?
So it's actually not a Russian name, which is quite interesting. It's a name from Italian origin, Vita especially. Like Vita is kind of an old
life,
world.
No?
Yeah, old world Italian name, which I find quite funny because growing up in Russia with Russian parents, my parents called me, you know, gave me this name. And, you know, in the end, I married an Italian man. I mean, how crazy is that? I feel like they wrote a destiny for me.
They did. Allora, le ha scritto il destino. Lei parla l'italiano?
I don't really speak Italian well, but there was a moment in my life when I was pregnant with my first. I had a lot of time and I dedicated my pregnancy time to learning Italian. I got to the point when I started to understand a lot And the teacher is like, okay, now you have to practice, like, tell your husband to practice with you. And I was like, okay. But he has zero patience, so we got it like in fight constantly because he was annoyed by my level of Italian. And I just told him, listen, if you don't want to speak Italian and you prefer English, like, that's it. I got to the point when I understand what he's saying on Italian, so he can't talk shit about me.
That's
and
good.
That's just good enough for
that's
me.
That's good enough. I say the same with my girlfriend. She doesn't want to speak Spanish, but she understands everything. Eu estou pegando aula de português com Marta Graff, our friend, in her TikToks.
Yeah.
Você quer falar português brasileiro? Não sei. Não. Não.
There's a difference, right? I don't know the difference, so.
So tem que, não sei, neither do I, man. But languages are complicated. But even Russian, imagine what, didn't your husband wanted to learn Russian?
No.
No?
I always love that the only thing he loves about Russia is me. He doesn't like Russian food. He doesn't like Russian music. But...
The
somehow,
polka. He doesn't like the polka.
No, I mean,
polka,
I don't know.
Is a Russian music
every time,
or is
every
it
time,
Polish?
Polka, I think it's...
Polish.
Yeah.
No.
Don't ask me those questions.
What is Russian music?
I don't want to embarrass myself. I mean, I don't know if you know this song. It's like... I feel like every foreigner maybe know. Kalinka, malinka, kalinka, maya. Sada yagda, malinka, kalinka, maya.
Vite, kalinka, maya. Vamos, kalinka, maya.
Now we need a shot of vodka to finish
and
it
caviar.
Up. Exactly.
See?
Good thinking. I love
so,
that.
Vite, there's a good Russian. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to go to Russia. I've never been in Russia.
So,
what are the things you love the most about Russia?
I know it will be a surprise for a lot of people, but last time I've been in Russia was... more than 12 years ago.
Wow.
So I moved to United States 12 years ago, and when I moved I was sure that this is going to be my base, that I want to live here. So I never been back since then. It just happened that my modeling career started to happen so fast, and I was pretty dedicated to it, and I felt like I couldn't take off work. So I end up basically being here for 12 years without going back to Russia. My parents always come to visit me because they love United States, and actually they're the one who kind of raised me with this like American dream. And I feel like every time they come here, they like enjoy their time so much that I, whenever I decide to come there, they're like, don't worry, we come to you. I'm like, okay, it's actually easy for me.
Okay, cute.
Yeah.
But
so answering your question, I didn't really travel myself Russia, as crazy as it is, because Russia is so big, and I'm from a tiny small town that is on the border with China, so it's kind of totally different from Moscow or other big cities. It's like a little town on the middle of nowhere, which is like heavily influenced by Asia. So so yeah. If you ever decide to go to Russia to like explore it, maybe I'll join you because I need to explore it too.
let's do it. I've been always wanted to go to Russia, and but yes, obviously it's a huge, huge country, and we all know about Moscow, we all know about St. Petersburg or the Tsar, the Father Bay, but also we do know about the beautiful women, and this is one of Russia's finest models. You have walked the runways for Victoria's Secret, done the campaigns for Hermes. Well, you're constantly a tastemaker and a content creator with a humongous following. But I wonder, how did this all started? When you were a young girl, you thought, like, I'm going to be a model, this is what I want to do, or where were you discovered, or...
It's an interesting
like Natalia Vodianova, you know?
I didn't grow up like dreaming to be a model. I feel like the modeling kind of happened to be in my life by chance, but then I grew into like loving it and see opportunity in it. So interesting story how I got into modeling. We had this modeling school, like, very stupid kind of, because it's like, I don't know what it gives you, but basically it's a modeling school for kids where you go and like learn catwalk and how to take care of yourself. I mean, like beauty in general, beauty is very worshipped in Russia culture. So mm-hmm. I felt like probably that's where it like came from, to like teach women how to like be a lady. So I went there with just like a fun idea to explore that, to like learn how to walk on a high heel. So I went there with my friend because she invited me. And funny enough, there was a casting for modeling agency in Japan. And out of everyone that was there, they chose me, which was like such a big surprise for me, because I never, going to the school, like I never imagined myself being like a model. It wasn't in my plan. And I felt like my friend was like very offended by it, that she wasn't chosen and I was, and it was like a big conflict. So I ended up going to Japan after a year. My mom was like super against it. Like, where are you going? Like, I was just 13 years old. Like, my mom was all
13.
Shocked. I was 13. So I had this like big contract to that time. Like, you know, they're paying me all this money to be there for 3 months doing modeling. Like, my mom was all shocked. Like, where are you going? This is crazy. Like, who are those people? Are they going to kidnap you?
Yes.
Like, the whole thing. You know, we did a little bit of research about the agencies. Like, it took her time to learn a little bit about the industry, what the agency was. You know, we met with them. It was like, you know, just to make sure that it was legitimate. So I went to one trip. It went well. I came back with a good amount of money. You know, obviously everyone was happy with it.
Cashin.
I did my first money when I was 13. Actually, it wasn't my first job. My first job was at the bakery.
This is what is woman in
power. But it was like my first at the big bakery. Money, you know?
But the bakery, you just did a couple bucks.
Exactly. But this one was like a real amount of money. And I just felt so like, I don't know. I feel like the money gives you this empowerment feeling.
Say it.
And I think that it's kind of addicting in a way, right? When you're financially independent and gives you like this ability to feel like you can manage those money and do with them whenever you want. It's kind of like gives you a very nice feeling inside. So that was my kind of first encounter with like a big money.
I love it because, and thank you for bringing this into the subject. Last week I was called as an ambassador for Vogue, Espacio Vogue.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, it has nothing really mm-hmm. to do with this, but all the chats are about women empowerment, but we were at a lunch and nobody could buy a ring of a couple $1,000s.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know, I need to get my husband. Great if you can get anybody or your special significant other to buy your things, which is fantastic because it's a present. But I was like, the most important thing about women empowerment with the foundation that I have 13 years and my own experience is to have that economical freedom, that independence that you're just talking with a big smile, but a little shy. You were a little shy about it. And I really want you to share, because sometimes as women, we think if you talk about that or like, and I was wondering on the conversations that we had with the editor of Vogue and some other designers and other people, it was like, is it a mindset that we don't ask for, or is it a what is it that women are still fighting for an equal pay or for an equal, you know, place on the table?
Right. I mean, coming back to a topic of just generally money, I think that, as I said, like, you know, raising a girl, I think it's definitely, I want to give her an example of like how to be independent and career driven. I think it gave me a lot of opportunities in life. I'm in no way like judging women that choose to be at home stay mom, which, by the way, the hardest freaking job in the world. And my, you know, I've been raised very differently in a different household, like very traditional Eastern European, where my dad worked all his life and my mom was home taking care of us and home. And like seeing my mom, she was very balanced and fulfilled as a woman, and I didn't felt like she had any sort of discomfort in her being in that place. And again, I think it comes a lot with the fact that we are living in a different place where, you know, it's not like a, city where we live right now, where it's a lot of things happening, and like I feel like there's a lot of pressure around. Mm. Where I'm from, it's like a smaller town where everyone lives in a sort of like the same way. So, and that's the way she kind of probably saw it and chose for her to be. I also think that, giving credit to my dad, like I'm grew up in such an amazing family. My mom and dad are still married, and growing up, I've seen such a beautiful example of love, and I think it gave me so much in life too. That's why I always say one of the biggest responsibility in life as a mom is choosing your partner wisely, because I just seen how much impact my father and my mom gave me with like their beautiful example of love. And despite the fact that my mom was like fully financially dependent on my dad, I never felt that my dad gave her a feeling that she's less, doing less effort,
yeah,
and putting less effort into a family than him. Where I think in a modern world, things a little mm-hmm. twisted, you know, a little bit.
True.
You know?
That you either tell the woman you're not doing anything, or you put the credit down, or yeah. the woman needs to prove and will.
So I think that, you know, in my family, as you know, right now being having my own family, I think just from my own angle, and again, I think every woman needs to choose what works for her, right? What works for me might not work for someone else, but I think I learned for myself that somebody that had financial freedom since age 13 cannot go and depend fully on my husband at age in my 20s, because it's just not mentally healthy for me. Like I didn't felt, you know, when I stopped working when I was pregnant, it just felt like I lost a piece of me. Like it's not even about the money, but it's more about like the process and having a goal and having the next thing to look forward to.
Why? Because of the time?
No, it's just like I think that generally, like as I said, like I used to the fact that I have my own financial freedom, and like I do things, you know, I'm looking forward to the next goal. Okay. And I think this is super important for me. Like this drive that I have is like addicting.
Yeah.
So like slowing down and being a homestay mom, I felt like I didn't have that anymore.
Okay.
As much I enjoy being a mom, I feel like it's healthier for me to have this balance where I can exist outside of home and being a mom, and also, you know, being a mom and at home stay mom and working mom at the same time. That works for me. But as I said, there is no judgment for women that chose not to pursue the career and be a full-time moms.
But I think every more often there's more women wanting to pursue their careers, and perhaps not with the same balance that you have it as being a working mom and flushing the fucking toilet while we're doing a podcast. Might not be the best combination in the world. But
life.
But that's life. You know. But there's a bunch of things that you said that I wanted to take care of. You were financially independent at 13 when you make your big contract. A friend of you invited you, and then she got pissed off. Yeah. What about sorority in this world of a jungle, and especially about among women? Because you see men working together, and you see sometimes women getting a contract and the other one not getting it, and having this competition, especially when you're modeling or where you're in a beauty contest. You see people just, or your best friends not being your best friends or being the biggest traitors. Did you ever have to experience that after 13, or how
I mean, entering modeling industry, I think we can all agree it's highly competitive business. That is very much focused on beauty. So I think, you know, growing up in that type of industry where it was all about judging you by the look, you know, now I feel like it's a little bit evolved, and they ask you to be a little bit more than just a look, which is great. But I think that back then it was pretty like old school where it was just all about measuring you. Like every week you would be in the agency, there would be with a measuring tape, like measuring your hips, measuring your waist, measuring your chest, and they wouldn't care like if, you know, if you had any excuse. Like you just had to be by parameters that's been written on a contract, and if you was one each right or left, this would like highly affect your check, you know, paycheck, which I think is absolutely crazy. But honestly, like I didn't know any better. I was just there and just playing by those rules. So it's a very kind of, intense environment where all the women are fighting for their spot. You know, entering the modeling as a child, I definitely was very insecure, and slowly I learned who I really was and what my values are. And it didn't happen until later, to be honest. Like it, you know, it took me a long time to get to that mindset where it's like, okay, if you don't want me, go, you know. But definitely I didn't have a lot of good friendships being in modeling industry. It's actually funny, I said to my husband the other day, I felt like finally when I'm almost 30 years old, I actually have real friends. And it just happened in the last, you know, couple of years, because I feel like I exited modeling fully and I started to be like in a real world of like people that want to get to know you, not just like be there for sort of benefits or, you know, something want to get from you or like want to be there for Instagram. I mean, you still meet those in Miami, yeah, of course,
everywhere.
But I feel like, you know, being a mom and being a little bit different environment, I have a lot more like deeper connections now with friends I have.
But I also don't like, it must have been hard because you started at 13 years old, moving from your hometown, you at a young age, you got a super huge contract and to pursue your dreams and that independence, economical independence, or your, you know, it's super fashionable. It's super exciting to get that that opportunity to be in the limelight, no? But at the same time, it comes with a lot of hardships. And then you have to transition. How do you explore your self-confidence, becoming yourself? And as the person, as you say, right now, 30, it's like, what is it, 13 to 30?
Yeah.
I'm not good at math, but it's somewhere around 20-something.
Yeah.
20-something years that you have to go through a lot of changes. And like in the modeling industry, as you say, when you probably started, it was like... I'll tell you my personal story.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up in the Amazons. You're going to have a drink, but you can't. because my father is a explorer and my mom too. But I have a whole lot of family around the fashion world. Carolina Herrera is my aunt, and the other aunt is a other famous designer, and blah, blah. And I wanted to be a model because I wanted to get my financial and economical freedom. And growing up in a family of strong macho men and very strong women as well. But I wasn't seeing that the family business was going to be the one who would give me that independence. So
right.
they had offered me some opportunities in the fashion thing. And when I went to this show that was happening in Venezuela with the big brands of Italy, La Perla, Armani, blah, blah. It was that time that the models were, and I'm much older than you, so there was the models of like really, really skinny and really, really tall. I did not fit the thing. I'm a football player. I'm tall, but I still have like sporty. So, but I did speak another language. So the casting director was Italian, and she couldn't communicate. I was like, ciao, allora, ah, ma allora, parli italiano? Yeah, abbastanza.
So you impressed
them. I don't speak shit.
Right, you pretended.
And I pretended, and the models were coming. She's like, tell her tomorrow at 9 a.m. And I was like, domani no vengas. Mañana no vengas. So I killed all the models, and there were only two other models that came the day after, and she had to put me on the show, and that's how I started my modeling career. I'm not very proud of it, but, you know, the law of survival.
Right.
But then again, they will keep telling you about your look, about your nose, about this, and at a point I couldn't find my self-confidence, and that will bring you a bunch of other issues in life Did it brought you any kind of disorder, issues with your image, with yourself?
I have a long history of like, you know, of I've been sharing it on my YouTube channel. The eating disorder that I had while modeling, gratefully I overcome this, and I think that I overcome this only at the time when I actually exited modeling and became a mom, and kind of like, I think motherhood changed me in a lot of ways, and like especially having a lot of respect for my body, like seeing that it created life, it like completely switched my mindset. But you know, I think it's pretty obvious that if you grow up always concentrated on how you look, you'll create an unhealthy relationship with anything. And I think it applies to anything. If you're too focused on one thing without having a balance in life, it will create eventually, you know, an obsession that will play tricks on your mind. And I think it did it with me, and I was really having an unhealthy relationship with food, always thinking that I need to lose weight, gaining weight, losing weight, and it's just been like a psychologically very hard. You know, I actually recently shared this, you know, eating disorder story. I think I shared it multiple times. And somebody asked me if I was like regretting the path I took, because, you know, all the models talk about the eating disorder and how horrible the industry is. And as bad as it is, and I'm not approving it in any way, and it's horrible what they were, you know, doing to all the young girls and how they affected us. But I'm not the type of person that took advantage of it and played by those rules, because in the end it was my decision to do it. Nobody forced me. I could just walk away anytime and take a ticket home and go and live my life. In the end, I played by those rules. I accepted it. I took the best I could, and I cannot talk badly about it, because, you know, like I objectively talk what's good, what's bad.
Yeah.
But when people ask me if I regret living it, I say no. Would I recommend it to someone? No, I say it's bad. But I think it's stupid to regret your past if it shaped you in the person you are today, because I don't know if I will be sitting with you today and having my beautiful family and living in a beautiful place if I wouldn't go through those hardships that I had.
You know, I love it, because most people will blame the industry. They will blame or like this. And nowadays we're having, as you say, an industry in the fashion world that is, you walked for Victoria's Secret, and now
you're like, I talk openly about the things that they've done wrong, you know, and I think that in any business, nobody running business perfectly.
No.
And they've done a lot of mistakes. And I think that as a business, they were catering to the people that were there, right? Mm-hmm. I think the world changed a little, and that's why we evolved a little in a little bit different space. And people weren't accepting at some point what they were representing there. But, you know, Victoria's Secret definitely was one of the hardest things I've done in my life, and it put me through a lot of stress. But I cannot be talking badly about them, because in the end, this is the goal I set for myself. I went willingly to that, and I also got like a lot of advantage after that. So I don't know, I'm not in a spot to like blame anyone. It's just in life, like I don't think there's the right way, like the right thing to blame things, someone else for things that you've done. In the end, you are the driver of your own life.
So you're responsible for yourself. Yes, absolutely. And what you're doing is taking responsibility. And it's not that I agree with Victoria's Secret or anything. I think they're fantastic. And whoever walked that runway, it gives you a lot of benefits with a lot of, you know, side effects.
Yeah.
And now it's interesting that you see not only Victoria's Secret being with an inclusive body positive image, but most of the designers. And the other day we were in Fashion Week in New York speaking to one of the great designers, and it says it's being like forced also now to be inclusive and body positive.
Yeah.
My designs are not made for that, because I don't feel that, and it should be democratic for everybody to fit in whatever they want to fit in. But I think also as a society, for many years, we have grown up with the idea of beauty being in a specific standard. So it makes us go through very hard situations of trying to get your body into ways that naturally is not genetically done that way. And everybody has a chance to be beautiful and to be creative and expressive, no?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not very politically correct, I think, expressing myself.
I love somebody who's not politically correct.
So a lot of people probably will attack me.
It's not going to be me. Go, say it.
So I think that, I mean, I already shared this thoughts, and I've got very mixed feelings from people. But I look at it this way. I think, yes, when I was in an industry, the parameters were extreme and they needed to be changed, right? And I think there was at some point where there was a change, but still there was a sort of a beauty standard in it. Where now I feel like there is no parameters at all. Anyone can be a model. And I'm not necessarily thinking it's right. Because what if tomorrow I want to be a basketball player and I don't have a height and I don't have a talent? So does it mean that now, you know, basketball society needs to lower the standard to meet my needs? And I think it applies the same to modeling. Like, yes, the beauty standard needed to be lower. Like, we don't need to be an exact same parameter. But I think that still modeling industry is about the beauty. And the beauty is not just about the look, you know? I remember, like, the first, I think, groundbreaking model that shocked everyone was Ashley Graham. Mm. And she was the first, like, plus-size model that became famous. And as shocking as it was, like, you know, nobody's seen a curvy girl like her on the cover of the magazine, especially representing a sexy girl, like it was a Sport Illustrated. And to be honest, like when I saw her, I thought she's stunning. And like seeing her interview, how much personality she has, like there was something in her mm-hmm. that will stop you and look at her and appreciate her and true. Like say, wow, she has it, you know, she has something in her. Where now, I honestly think 90% of the model that I see, yes, they're inclusive. Yes, it's inclusive and everyone can relate to it. But like looking at those pictures, like I don't feel anything. Does it make sense?
See, it's like music.
It's like it's nothing there. It's like there is no personality in a lot of cases, no like beauty. Like why?
I don't know, because we have all these little things now that everybody has to be inclusive. You have to call people this. You have to have a, you know, now mm-hmm. like I have an organization that for 13 years we use soccer, which is a super male dominated sport, to
yeah,
give
it.
Young mm-hmm. girls social emotional skills. And they want to sit you on the table just because they need to be inclusive and they need to have a girl or they need to have somebody of color or they mm-hmm. need to have this. And not because of your abilities, as what you're saying.
But I think it's not good because that lowers the motivation of
it lowers
people.
Everything for yeah. everybody. It's not as good as you are. You just fit in the profile and then you get the job. And I think you have to get a job because you're the best one
absolutely.
At it.
Yeah.
You work your ass off.
Yeah.
Even if you had to go through those difficult times, nowadays you have a very healthy well-being and you're very open about it in your social media, but also about what you eat. And I understand that there's a lot of people that are haters and the criticism.
Listen, the reality is people are so sensitive nowadays, whatever you say is wrong. So at this point, you're like, whatever. I just say whatever I think.
That's a Russian Vita. I say whatever I think and I like her and I vote for Vita.
I mean, yes, there. You know, I think that it's pretty sad to see because to be honest, like I loved America for free speech and how people are just like free to express themselves. And coming from a background where our country is opposite of that, mm-hmm. is very, I would say, communistic country. We're becoming one. I don't like to go into politics, of course, but
why not?
Because
let's dig into politics.
I just don't like to talk about things that I'm not expert at. You know, there's a lot of like people on Instagram would be like, oh, you know, now we're having this, you know, horrible war between Ukraine and Russia, which is absolutely heartbreaking. And I, you know, I said in a lot of times on my Instagram that I'm not supporting it, but people like want more. They want more from you and like, you know, for you to express your opinion. And I'm like, I don't know a lot about the politics. Like, no. I cannot speak about a topic that I don't know about. Like, there is a journalist who studies this and who knows a lot about it, and I'm like there to learn. But like my account, my Instagram account is not about politics. Like, that's
true. And I am.
So sorry, I was going to cancel culture. So yes. coming from that background where we are like kind of suppressed, mm-hmm. I appreciated a lot about US, the fact that you can like express yourself, your thoughts. And I honestly believe that, you know, we don't know everything. None of us know everything. And I think that, you know, by asking questions and by expressing your opinion, this is how conversation happens. And by like having these restrictions, I feel like we don't learn. People don't have conversations anymore. We have a cancel culture where whatever you say is wrong. They always see through some things that are not even there. And honestly, like, it became very difficult on even social media to like express your opinion a lot of times, because people are just like waiting there to jump on you and cancel you. And I think it's absurd.
I agree with you. Listen, I grew up in the middle of the jungle with a lot of freedom. Then I went into a city and they will tell me not to do things just because I was a girl, or, you know, shut up because of this. And then I went to have a whole career even of challenging the status quo within my family and what they expected of me. And even today, I was saying, I worked and I had the blessing to my first job to be as a host of MTV. Mm-hmm. They wanted me to be bold and ask things.
MTV was very big in Russia too. Like, it's a big brand. It was huge,
and yeah. it was about your boldness. It was about, like, you know, celebrating differences, and it was that moment of creating. Now we've turned into an era, which I understand that the bulliness and, you know, people, we should all be able to achieve things. But yeah, I want to be a musician, but man, I cannot even sing. Even if I want to, why would that have to be democratic? Then my country, Venezuela, became into a turmoil. And we were just in Cuba for my birthday, and they were like, oh, this is a beautiful country, and it's amazing. And yeah, it's amazing, but there's not an ATM, there's no food, there's only one TV channel if you have turn. And that's if you have electricity.
You're lucky.
And that if you have water.
Right.
And that is if, like, you know. So there's all these sides that sometimes with the world that we have, we tend to enhance these ideals that have not brought anything equally to anybody but misery. Mm-hmm. And for putting you in a spectrum of not learning, of not having to express, or yes, they're happy because you surrender, because there's no other hope. You just have to deal with it. And in any case, I didn't want to bring this conversation into politics, but I think the sensibility that you have of America has a lot of bad things, but it's a country that I was able to form my business, that technology has given me the opportunity.
I mean, it comes the same way as for my modeling career. I'm like, I can't blame a country that that gives me so much opportunity. And I do think still, you know, nobody's perfect, as any human as well, and you always have to measure pluses and minuses. And I feel like US still has a lot of pluses that overcome the minuses, and I think that's why we're all here.
Exactly.
But I do feel like in the last few years, we went a little bit into a weird space
where it's a shit show.
Yeah, where everyone is so sensitive, and I feel like we entered the culture where everyone likes to blame everyone for their own failures. Like, and I think that's kind of putting blaming other people and putting responsibilities on someone else never creates anything good. Like, it's.
So I'm just saying, you have a bunch of thousands of followers, and perhaps they will, some of them will criticize, oh, like, yeah, you're saying you have an eating disorder, and like, you're skinny and you're beautiful and you have this. Everybody has a little kind of a bitchiness around it. How do you navigate through that and move forward? And yeah,
you're not going to please everyone. That's something I understood. And it comes to everything. Like, they criticize everything. They criticize your family life, they criticize your whatever you say, your style. I mean, it's just normal. I think it's normal. We are humans and we're not meant to agree on everything. I do think that sometimes, like, it boils my nerves. I'm like, okay, nobody asked your opinion. Why are you DMing me about like a message like this about criticizing?
They and do I, that?
Oh yeah, like
a huge
one woman
DM.
Would like
DM,
like a person would spend, I swear, like the message long like this, like she probably spent an hour on it. I'm like, who has time? She wrote me a letter, like expressing her thoughts about my personal life, about my marriage, about my career. It's like, wow, girl, you have a lot of time in hands.
Shit.
So, you know, and in the end, you put yourself, I get boiled sometimes and I'm like, why are you doing this? You know, I'm writing this on Instagram, like, okay, stop DMing me about like things that I don't ask you. But in the end, when I come down, it's like, okay, you know what? I chose this career to put myself out there. People see what I'm doing. And I guess DM's there for a reason.
Yeah.
And my choice is like not to open this DM if I don't want to see it.
No, man, you've gone through hard times too, and people don't see that, and they just see the beauty of it, and it's super easy to criticize or have an opinion. What do you do to listen to your intuition? And as we were speaking at the beginning, so you do it in Spanish, you do it in English, and you told me, trust your gut. Very straightforward. That Vita is no, tiene carácter. How do you trust your own intuition when you hear all this? How do you turn off all those little voices? Do you exercise? Do you meditate? Just go
not
back
meditate.
To...
Not meditate.
No?
I mean, I do yoga. I like yoga, but I'm not like... I like spirituality, but
you
I
do a lot of exercise because I see...
I love working. Working out is my meditation.
See?
I always say yes. It's like, I think the adrenaline gives me and just like...
But you do heavy workout or stretching or...
Do everything.
Everything.
Mixing it. But... What are we talking about?
About how do you turn off those little voices? How do you like
yes.
you like trust your gut and say this is my plan and I'm going for it no matter whoever's in is in and whoever's out is out.
I think that I always had this personality trait where I was doing things that are true to like I've always been true to myself since I was a little girl. I remember. Funny story, and that's something that actually my mom brought up in one. I did only one Russian interview on my channel, and my mom was in it because my mom doesn't speak English, but I really wanted to bring her in because I think that like people meeting her will see her, and like she deserved that place.
You
too,
love
like
your
to,
mom no?
Yeah, I love my parents.
I love my mother too.
And she actually brought this memory where she said like I knew you had that drive in you and that like character in you from early age. Like I never was worried about you that somebody will like, you know, involve you in like drugs or alcohol, because she said I knew that you had good example of us and a very strong character. And I remember there was something like at school, and then Russian system is like you're not supposed to talk back to the teacher and not supposed to discuss anything. Like there is only teacher opinion and no one else.
That's it.
So and when I was in first grade, I think there was some sort of like we had to learn a poem or I don't remember exactly the details. But basically, I was disagree with a teacher and I stood up and I was like 7 years old and I told the teacher, I think you think this way, but I think differently. And I told her my thoughts, what I thought. And she basically called my parents the next day to come to school. And she told them that I discredited her in front of all the class expressing my opinion. So my mom said, of course, she apologized because she didn't want to create conflict, but she said when she left, she felt very, I don't know, she said she felt like a feeling that, okay, this girl, like, she has her own opinion.
With a lot of proudness, the pride that a mother can have, because even I can imagine growing up in a country like that, that you have to keep your opinion to yourself, seeing your daughter and supporting you, that you have your God's very put, well put.
Yeah.
So I don't think any bad comment will ever put you down.
No, I think that it's affecting me. Like it's affected me in before. I think now I grew into like being resilient to it. But I do think that for me, like a good exercise that you said, like, how did you come to like, okay, just go for things that you want to do. I think that for me was a good exercise is starting my YouTube channel 1.5 years ago. And I think it was going out of, we were talking about, yeah, we start recording, going out of comfort zone.
Yeah.
I've been doing modeling for so long, and that's literally the only thing I knew how to do. I don't have education. Like, I only finished high school. I didn't go to university because I pursued my modeling career.
But she speaks 3 languages.
So I have no shame in it.
And is financially independent since 13.
So I just lost the thought.
No, what you were trying to tell me is like, I'm sorry, what was it that you said? That, your mother was like, yeah. Come on, we can find it.
I know. It's going to come.
But you know what? What I think it's important, because sometimes you put yourself down with the idea of not being...
Yes, so I was talking that, coming back. Yeah. I remember now. So before we start recording, we were talking about...
putting yourself out there.
Going out of a comfort zone. I think that modeling, it was something I've been doing all my life. And mm-hmm. that's the only thing I knew how to do. I finished high school, I didn't go to university, so it's kind of like the only thing I kind of was focused on. And I think like reinventing myself, because, you know, the modeling wasn't serving me anymore. I wanted to be in Miami, I wanted to be with my family, I didn't want to travel as much anymore. I saw that there is an opportunity in content creation, and I kind of started to turn my content around, and it was, you know, Instagram, like, quite slowly I started to turn, and it was not as uncomfortable because still the platform was quite familiar for me. But YouTube is something that was a little bit more scary for me, because I have a barrier with language. I've always felt like, okay, I'm a foreigner, like, I have an accent, how are the people going to feel about it? And also, like, what am I going to film? Like, do I have enough to tell to people? Like, what do they want to know? Okay, maybe I know how to come up with 10 videos, but like 100, 1,000? Like, I don't know if I'm going to have ideas. So as you said, we always lower ourselves and putting ourselves
down.
But I saw it as a challenge, and I have to give a credit to my husband. I think I was like brewing this idea in myself for quite a bit of time, maybe for like, I created a channel, probably 7 years before I launched it, okay?
What?
But it took me so long to actually do it, okay? And that's all about overthinking. So I was overthinking for 7 years. And finally,
that's not a good business, Vita.
And finally, when I step out of modeling and I was like, what's next? I was like, okay, YouTube is my next thing. I really want to do it. I love YouTube. I like the idea of YouTube. And I was brewing it in me for maybe 6 months, and I was sharing it with my husband. And it's like, my husband is like super private person. He has Instagram, but like, he doesn't post anything. And I, you know, also like, I don't know, I wanted to do YouTube about my life. Like, he has to be in it too. And I was like, how he's going to feel about it. And I felt like I was sharing so much with him that at some point he's like, just do it. Like, why you keep talking about it and not doing anything about it? And I was like, yeah, but you know, like, it's so scary. Like, you know so many people here, and I know, like, we in the end, we do care about what people think, you know? And that's, I think it's a human nature.
It is.
You know? And he's like, just do it. Who cares? And I think that he gave me this push and like, okay, go for it. Like, stop talking about it. Do it, actually. And I think it's first time, like, I for in a long time, I went out of my comfort zone completely and started to record the videos. Like when I first look at my first video, I didn't delete it. I was like, this is going to be a great memory for me to go back to. I look very uncomfortable and feel very uncomfortable now watching it. But I learned that as you go, you learn. And as you practice, you become more confident and you become more aware of what you're doing. And you only can improve by learning.
Yeah. And I think when you start connecting with the audience, like for instance, like I've never done a podcast in my life. I just wanted to do it because I have a sense of like my calling is the communications. I wanted to be a model because it represented me a whole thing, but I'm not the 1.90 meter or the poser, even though you're going to have to show me how to walk the runway of the thing. Because my friend Esteban Cortazar, who's a designer, he was here. He showed me how to walk for his runway because I'm from the Amazon. I will walk very much of a very strong walk. Mm-hmm. And afterwards, Vita is going to give us a runway tip.
Yeah, but I have high heels now, so, you know.
She's got some high heels, lady. But ultimately, what you have is the connection with the audience, and that is realness, man. And it's the way that you can be empathetic to, and how can, now it's about being vulnerable and showing all your problems. But no, it's about having that connection. And I think maybe you will be shy at the first video, but you do have that genuine, empathetic connection with your followers and in your YouTube and in every video that you share. So
keep
doing
it,
and it's amazing. Sometimes are topics that I feel that they're interesting for me, or maybe some of them are not, but for your followings. And it's interesting to you because it's something that you're sharing from your own experience. Sometimes you see my podcast and you see like, what the fuck, I don't have no interest in listening to this, but
yeah, but as we said, it applies to everything. You can't please everyone, and you just do your own thing,
and you find. But there is a connection through the genuinity, and you do have it. So whatever people will tell you, I think everybody has nowadays mostly an opinion towards everything. But with the skepticism and the cynicism that they will come out at you, you also have the right to prove them wrong.
Yeah,
you did something right, and you also have the right also to fail, because sometimes you'll do projects, and those projects, the world wasn't changed, and we don't have all these commodities nowadays because of people who follow the same guidelines and the same structure and the same laws. It was people who were bold. They were called crazy, and that who dared to promote or propose different ways and challenge that status quo that keep us always in the little box.
Yep.
So, come on, give us some love, at least credit, A for effort to all of us. And I think it's amazing that you're doing what you're doing, and that you have evolved. Not only because of reinventing yourself, but as a woman in your evolution, the strength, I don't know much, and this conversation of 40 minutes will not take me as far as I would love to know from your beginnings, but you have a solid fucking base, Vita.
And I still feel like I'm in transition period.
But all your life, because they asked me the other day in this Q&A's that I do every Sunday, it's like, when was the moment that you felt you knew yourself, or like, no, man, it's
never
like you. I hope that you're still evolving and being open to other possibilities or ideas, because otherwise we just tend to close ourselves and we end up in politics and in places that just limit us. They don't define us. It's like the same thing we do with sports. Football is not something that women can play. It's the stereotypes of what they put of what women can do. Mm-hmm. And sometimes when you say that you didn't have an education, you have values, which is for me.
No, I honestly say it because I don't have a
a college degree. Okay, mira, most people go to college to get a job. Because when you put the resume, people will see that for 4 years you were constant in going to a classroom and doing some homework. So that might give them a chance that their business is going to be kind of taken care of. But But ultimately, the school of life and the values that your family have given you, they don't teach you in this education system.
I agree.
That's why I do the program that we do, because I think the values that we teach in the sorority, for women supporting women, for resilience, for taking better decisions, for discipline, mm-hmm. for all the things that your family taught you. You didn't have to go to school. So never, I think it's also important to not put yourself down that you didn't have an education. I have the best education. My mom and my dad.
I had my own education.
My mom and my dad.
I had my own way.
Ivy League.
But honestly, like, I also don't think that education is something like we put in, as you said, in a very... like, we always judge things by a traditional way. And I think we always, you know, think, okay, you finish school, you have to go to university. But I honestly think that, especially I like the fact that in United States, it's kind of common that people go and learn and study later in life. It's like very common, where in my country, it's not common. Like if you are past certain age, like people are scared to go to university because you're going to be the only one there that at a certain age, where here it's like very common. And I think it's beautiful because in the end, you want to choose profession that will be useful to you and will be interesting. Where as a young person, if you tell me now to choose which university to go to and career paths to take at age of 18, I'll not know.
No, but maybe you can start doing the school of influencer, because you men, I don't know. I try to do content, but I'm very bad at it. It's like the morning, the ritual, the content, the film, the get ready with me. You are a mother, a wife. You create content. How do you manage all
you
this?
See how maybe you see me from outside? Because I don't feel this way.
Vita, I see you all your videos. I said, fucking Vita is doing the video. How could she do 1, 2, 3, 4?
And I mean, I feel like I did get into a rhythm, but to be honest, like I don't feel like I'm having my shit together when it comes
maybe
to content.
Maybe you do the University of Influencers.
Maybe, who knows?
And there's a trend about, like, now influence is getting to the next level. Mm-hmm. So maybe the school of creating content. You're very good at it, let me tell you.
Thank you. I mean, I do it my way. I don't know if there's, like, you know, to teach someone. I don't know if there's, like, a rule to teach.
Bueno, you start creating that guideline. I don't know about podcasts, but I could start doing a guideline. Of, if you want to start your podcast, because Vita, who I've seen around, barely spoke two words. And then the other day, she's like, oh, I like your podcast. I was like, yes, we're doing something good.
Yes.
I love it, man. And congratulations for everything you're doing.
Thank you.
Keep shining the light.
Of
strength. But I'm really curious, because I think when you go to a country, the first things you need to know, it's how to pronounce Vita's name, how to say hi, mm-hmm. how to ask for food, and or for a ride, but also how to say fuck you.
Okay.
How do you curse,
like,
in Russian?
Do I really have to do it?
Yeah, well.
I mean, is it common to do it here? I can do it.
Of course. This is a way. Let's go. I can curse in Spanish. I can tell you how to curse in Spanish, because now you live in Miami. You need to know how to speak Spanish.
Okay. Yeah. I mean.
Coño. Coño.
I know that one, I think. Because I think that Italian, there's something similar.
No, Italian, cazzo.
Cazzo, exactly.
Cazzo. In French, it's coná.
In Russian, fuck will be пиздец.
Come on?
Пиздец. Пиздец. You see, it's a good warm-up for your tongue. You're doing it at the beginning.
My tongue twisters now are going to be cursing in Russian.
Пиздец.
Пиздец.
Yeah.
Дец. Ends with дец.
Yeah.
Тома по ку. Тома на ку.
What's that?
Sorry.
Do I have to repeat that too?
No. Yes. You should.
So what else did I say?
Do I have another one? Pizniets, it's fuck. Pizniets.
You know, I like to be a classic girl.
No, bitch.
I'll just cut with one.
No. Natalia Bodianova told me how to say bitch.
Yeah?
Sí.
So you see, now you add one word to dictionary. Bitch, suka. You knew that.
Viste, claro. Te estoy diciendo otra más.
I'm trying not to curse because I have now a 4.5-year-old, and she told her first cursed word about 4 weeks ago. So me and my husband made a promise that we will stop cursing at home.
Which was the word she first said?
I mean, it was so innocent, but it was something that my husband always says.
Which is?
She was just playing and she was like putting toys away and she was just by herself there. And I was like in another room, but still close by that I could hear it. And she was just putting something and she's like, what the fuck? And I was like, and I was like, I literally was in another room, like Googling what I should do in this case. I was like, what do you do when your child says the first cursing word? And the first they said, do not pay attention.
But you made.
So I just ignored it. I don't know if that's going to work. It's still a learning process for me. She repeated it multiple times after. But now that we don't curse anymore, I feel like it's been quiet maybe for a week.
Allegra. What the fuck?
Mira. But she said it in such a, like, I could hear it. She said it in a way that she probably didn't even understand the meaning. I mean, she understood that it's probably in some, like,
the expression,
frustrating moment. But I don't know if she fully, like, understood the meaning.
I love it. And kids, they copy everything.
There's Oh my God, I have to tell you. Today I picked her up from school and I posted it on Instagram. I mean, things they say, it's hilarious. So I picked her up from school and she goes, Mom, I tried margarita today. And I was like, haha, I hope without alcohol. And she was like, pizza. She was like, took a second. She was like, Mom, it was pizza. And I was like, oh my God.
Your dirty mind thinking.
Margarita is my favorite drink.
Skinny margaritas. Mira, no, dude.
Spicy margarita.
Now, woo! With the jalapeno.
Exactly, my favorite drink.
Bueno, in 9 months, we go to down to Mexico.
Exactly.
To have ones. But listen, I think it's amazing what you do. There's a study in Harvard that says that people that actually curse have less chances to get sick. Because they are actually be able to express themselves. Mm-hmm. I love the way you express yourself with the elegance and the classiness. You don't need to say bad words, but all your content has a way of that is related to you and is related to everybody. It's been a pleasure to have you at the Zingg.
Thank
this is
you
your
so
house.
Much.
I want to give you a little something for you and Allegra.
That's so cute.
Oh, the goleadoras.
Oh, that's so sweet. So what is this?
Girls with balls, do not Google the girls with balls because it's up to your own.
Yeah, I'm not.
Do not show that Google to girls with balls to Allegra because I don't know what she's going to say. She's like, what the fuck? Dad, mom!
Will be another addition to her, knowledge.
Completely different. But
it will be an 18-year-old present.
No. It can be now.
It's a small size?
See, it's a small size. Oh, it's cute. Goleadoras. It's a non-for-profit, and we use soccer to empower
beautiful girls.
Thank We're
you.
Opening centers in
I
Miami.
I love the name. It's cool.
Bueno, you have to be a little bit bold to be able to support this. Bazaar for Good is actually supporting Goleadoras this year, so are you doing something for Bazaar for Good? You're
a big
supporter.
I'm always supporting, yes.
You have a big heart. So
I'm there.
Let's keep scoring some goals. Maybe you come and play some football.
Yeah. I mean, I'm honestly never played football in my life, but listen, I'm down for anything new.
you play the number 69.
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
You just
love that already.
You just score some goals.
Listen, I'll just look pretty and running after the ball.
And she's brilliant and smart, and not just pretty, but with a wonderful heart. It's an honor to have you here at
the
Zingg.
Thank you so much.
Follow Vita Sidorkina.
Sidorkina.
You probably will know how to pronounce the name much better than I do. What's my name?
Eglantina.
Zingg. With double G. This has been an episode of the Zingg with double G. If you find any value in this conversation, share it, follow her. You know the drill. You can find the Zingg in any of the podcast or platforms you get your podcast, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube. Give some heart, send some comments. And how do you say I love you in Russian?
Я тебя люблю.
Я тебя люблю. Спасибо. Thank you.